That we celebrate the resurrection of Jesus Christ. And so it's important. Without the resurrection, nothing matters, you know. If Jesus didn't rise from the dead, your faith is a big waste. The time you spend is a waste. Serving Jesus is a waste. Nothing matters. Do whatever you want to do. But Jesus has risen from the dead, so it all does matter. And so I want us to look this morning at the subject, Jesus Christ is Lord, and what that means for our daily lives. If you have a Bible, I'd invite you to turn with me to Psalm 110. Psalm 110. This is one of the psalms, as you turn there, that is quoted most in the New Testament regarding the resurrection of Jesus Christ. The others are Psalm 16 and Psalm 2, which Alvin Lynn read in your hearing. I want this morning to talk to you about three things: how Jesus, your King, is reigning right now. As you're seated here, he's reigning. And Jesus, your priest, is serving right now. And Jesus, your Lord, will be victorious. Christ has won the victory, and he will ultimately conquer all of his foes. So let's take time and just read through this psalm. It's a short psalm, and talk about it a little bit. The end result, what this sermon is aiming at, is that each one of us would offer ourselves to the King freely. So let's read Psalm 110. Please hear God's word. The Lord says to my Lord, sit at my right hand until I make your enemies your footstool. The Lord sends forth from Zion your mighty scepter. Rule in the midst of your enemies. Your people will offer themselves freely on the day of your power in holy garments. From the womb of the morning, the dew of your youth will be yours. The Lord has sworn and will not change his mind. You are a priest forever after the order of Melchizedek. The Lord is at your right hand. He will shatter kings on the day of his wrath. He will execute judgment among the nations, filling them with corpses. He will shatter chiefs over the wide earth. He will drink from the brook by the way. Therefore, he will lift up his head. Now, the psalm, if you have if you've read it in the Bible, it says it's a psalm of David, and many people dispute whether David wrote this, but Jesus said that David wrote it, so that settles and finishes that argument in the gospel accounts. And in this particular passage, you see the Lord twice, and it's written differently. The name is written differently. One is in all caps, and one is just the L is capitalized, and the others are lowercase. And that's because, as you may know, in the Hebrew, the original language, there are two different words here. The one that has all caps is Yahweh. It stands for the fullness of God, God in his, you know, essence. The word that just has the capital L is the word Adonai, which means my Lord. It's more personal in the sense of my master, the one who's ruling me. And the Lord, Yahweh, points to the one who rules all things, everything. And David is the one who's writing this psalm, and he says he's king at the point in which he's writing this, But the king, King David, he has a master. And he says that the Lord, the triune God, is speaking to the Lord. And we know that the Lord, Adonai, points to Jesus Christ. It points to the Lord. And it is the time frame that it is pointing to is the resurrection and the ascension of Jesus Christ. He's saying, sit at my right hand until I make your enemies a footstool for your feet. And so in previous weeks we talked about how in the prophecy of Daniel in chapter 7, you have the prophet Daniel looking ahead to this particular time. And in Daniel chapter 7, verse 13, Daniel says, I saw in night visions, and behold, with the clouds of heaven, there came one like a son of man. And he came to the Ancient of Days and was presented before him. And to him was given dominion and glory and a kingdom that all peoples, nations, and languages should serve him. His dominion is an everlasting dominion which shall not pass away, and his kingdom one that shall not be destroyed. You have to understand something about prophecy is that when prophets heard from God or saw a vision from God, they always stood in the presence of God. So their vantage point is heaven. They're seeing things from heaven's viewpoint. And so when Daniel is receiving this vision, it's like he's caught up in the heavens and he's seeing what's happening in heaven. Or from his standpoint, what will happen in heaven. And so he sees someone as he's in heaven receiving this vision from the Lord. He sees someone coming from earth up to heaven on a cloud to the Ancient of Days, and he is receiving an everlasting kingdom and an eternal dominion. And so what Daniel is seeing is Jesus Christ at his ascension coming from earth to heaven. It's the same vision that we see in Acts chapter 1, but only from earth's vantage point. On earth, the apostles see Jesus, and he goes up on a cloud. Then he disappears. And then angels are standing there saying, why are you looking into heaven? Get to work. The same Jesus who you see has left will come in the same way that he left. And so Daniel's seeing the same thing that the apostles saw at the ascension. It's just that they're seeing it in two different places. Daniel's in heaven seeing it. The apostles are on earth seeing it. It's the same thing. And so when you go back to Psalm 110, and you see that the Lord, God the Father, is saying to God the Son, sit at my right hand. Which is, you know, it's wrong if you're visualizing two seats in heaven. The thrones in this particular time were like a couch. So God's throne is huge, and God is a spirit. And so it's a metaphor. It's pointing to the privileged position of absolute authority. God's right hand is the position of absolute privilege and authority. It is the highest place of all. It is the most preeminent place there is, and Jesus is told, sit at my right hand. And then God is saying, I'm going to serve you now. I'm going to make your enemies your footstool. And so this is a profound image of what takes place in heaven. See, our vantage point, our point of view is often earthly. And we often don't see things the way they really are. Looks are deceiving. You cannot judge a book by its cover. Things are not as they appear. But what has happened since Jesus has been risen from the dead is he has gone to be with his Father in heaven. He has taken his seat as the King of the universe, and he is reigning right now, presently, as we are seated here. He's not waiting to come back and set up some kind of kingdom in Jerusalem. He's not waiting to come back and finally get to reign. Jesus is reigning right now. He is the king. And so he says, I'm going to make your enemies your footstool. Look at, we go back just for a moment to the letter where we have our sermon series in Ephesians chapter 1. Ephesians chapter 1, verse 19, Paul is in the middle of a prayer, and he's been asking God to do certain things for the people of God, and he gets to verse 19, and he starts asking this particular request. He wants us to know the immeasurable greatness of his power toward us who believe. Then he says, according to the working of his great might that he worked in Christ when he raised him from the dead and seated him at his right hand in the heavenly places, far above all rule and authority and power and dominion and above every name that is named, not only in this age, but also in the age to come. So you see that this is something that has already taken place. Jesus has already been exalted above everyone. And then in verse 22 it says, and he put all things under his feet and gave him as head over everything for the church. And so everything is already subject to Jesus' feet. Everything has been made his footstool already. Now you don't see it fully, do you? But it has already taken place. And so what the psalmist is looking ahead to is that all of Jesus' enemies have been made his footstool. Now let's look at this a little bit more deeply, because it can be confusing. And if we have to have heaven's vantage point. In 1 Corinthians chapter 15, 1 Corinthians chapter 15, it says in verse 20, but in fact Christ has been raised from the dead, the first fruits of those who have fallen asleep. For as by a man came death, by a man has come also the resurrection of the dead. For as in Adam all die, so also in Christ shall all be made alive, but each in his own order. Christ the first fruits. Then it says, at his coming, those who belong to him. When Jesus comes back again, he's going to raise you from the dead. That's what's going to happen when he comes back. Now in John chapter 6, it says four times. When is that going to happen? It happens on the last day. That's when you get raised from the dead, on the last day. The last day of history as we know it. That's when you get raised from the dead. If you go on to read, in 1 Corinthians 15, it says in verse 26, the last enemy to be destroyed is death. When you're raised from the dead, death has been destroyed. That's the last enemy to be destroyed. So until the last enemy is destroyed, Jesus is presently subjecting all of his other enemies to his power. Look at what it says in verse 25. For he must reign until he has put all his enemies under his feet. The last enemy to be destroyed is death. And so Jesus is presently subduing his enemies as we're sitting here. Now how on earth is that happening? There's so much evil in the world. There's so much wickedness in the world. How can you say that he's subduing his enemies and the only enemy left to subdue is death? It doesn't make any sense. People are still being robbed. Nations are still being, in North Korea, right? 33 Christians, specifically because they were Christians, were put to death because they were Christians. This is 2014. How can you say? Well, look at what it says here. It says, sit at my right hand until I make your enemies your footstool. The Lord sends forth, verse 2 and 3 explain how this is true and how it's going to take place. The Lord sends forth from Zion your mighty scepter. Rule in the midst of your enemies. Your people will offer themselves freely on the day of your power in holy garments. From the womb of the morning, the dew of your youth will be yours. That last statement is a little confusing, but hopefully we'll be able to shed light on it. Verse 2 is saying that the Lord, God the Father, is sending forth from Zion the mighty scepter of Jesus Christ. A scepter is what a king holds. You know what a scepter is. A scepter demonstrates that it's his power to reign, it's his power to rule. Remember in the story of Esther, you could only approach the king if he held a scepter out to you, and if you didn't, it was death. You could never approach the king, but if he held out a scepter, that means you could now enter his presence. And so it's a sign of his authority, his power, his absolute sovereign reign. And so the Bible is saying here, God the Father is promising his Son, Jesus, I'm going to send your mighty scepter, your sovereign reign, and it's going to come from Zion. And so the way Jesus extends his reign and extends his kingdom is through Zion. Now, Zion in Scripture is a dwelling place of God. Jerusalem was called Zion. It was a place where God lived. It was his earthly headquarters when he was in the Old Covenant. But now, Jerusalem is no longer. Remember what Jesus told the Samaritan woman? Behold, I tell you, there's coming a day when not here on this mountain will you worship me, but those who worship the Father will worship him in spirit and in truth. And so God's dwelling place right now, God's temple is where? It's the church. You're Zion. You're the dwelling place of God. This is the temple of the living God. And so where God's people are, that's where God sends out the sovereign reign of Jesus. It's through his people. It's right here in the church that Jesus exercises his authority, and from out of the church, he exercises authority throughout the world. That's how he advances his kingdom. It's through the church. You know, when God created the world, he just said, let there be light. It was by his word that everything was brought under his control. Nothing's changed. It's through the proclamation of his word that God still subdues the world and the people in it. Now it says, the Lord sends forth his mighty scepter from Zion. And he says, rule in the midst of your enemies. Now this is interesting. You go back in history and you find that Israel was in bondage in Egypt and Pharaoh was ruling over them. So this is what I mean when things are not the way they look like. Now, when you look at Israel and Egypt, it looks like they're losing. They're being oppressed. They're being killed. And they're being, you know, subjected to Pharaoh, who thinks he's God. And it looks like, how on earth is God ruling in the midst of his people? Well, then you read Exodus 9, 15 and 16, and then you get the aha moment. God says to Pharaoh, Pharaoh, I could have killed you a long time ago, but the reason I raised you up to power, the reason why you're Pharaoh, the reason why I gave you this kingdom, the reason why I put you on the throne, Pharaoh, and so that the whole world thinks Pharaoh is the top and Egypt is the strongest power there is, Pharaoh, the reason why that happened to you was so that I could proclaim my own name, God says, throughout the world, and so that I could demonstrate how powerful I was. So God waited for Satan to work through Pharaoh to get him to a certain power, to get him to a certain prominence. And then God, once Pharaoh had the renown of the world, everybody praised Pharaoh. He's the Egyptian Pharaoh. He's the greatest there is. He's a superpower in the world, and nobody can get with him. Then God comes down to Egypt and wipes him out. And God makes a name for himself. And exalts his own name and exalts his own fame, because at that point nobody knew who the Lord was. Pharaoh's like, well, who's the Lord? I don't know the Lord. I'm the only one who's the Lord here. I don't acknowledge any other God but myself. But Pharaoh found out who the real Lord was when his whole army got drowned in the Red Sea. And God throughout this whole thing is bringing praise and worship to himself, to the true and the living God. So God exercises his rule in the midst of his enemies. Then you look ahead to Jesus. And Jesus, you know, you look at Jesus on the day of his trial, doesn't look much like a Messiah. You know, everybody's lying about him and he's not doing much. Pilate is washing his hands of the whole thing. Herod's making fun of him. People are tying thorns and putting it on his head and making fun of him, spitting in his face, putting a bag over his head and punching him and saying, "You're the Messiah, prophesy, who hit you?" He knew exactly who hit him, but he didn't say anything. And you see Jesus hanging on a cross. It doesn't look much like a Messiah. It doesn't look much like a conquering king. But get this. This is very important. You don't necessarily get this unless you read carefully, and I didn't get it at first, so I started reading carefully. In Matthew chapter 27, it says something very interesting. In Matthew 27, verse 28, it says, "And they stripped him," talking about Jesus, "they stripped him and put a scarlet robe on him, twisted a crown of thorns, they put it on his head, put a reed in his right hand." And then verse 31, it says, And when they had mocked him, they stripped him of the robe and put his own clothes on him and led him away to crucify him. Now that word stripped is very important. You'll see why in a moment. But God waited for Rome. Rome is the greatest power that this world had ever seen at this point. Rome is the most fierce nation that ever existed. Nobody messed with Rome. It was death. Everybody feared Rome. Alexander the Great was one of the greatest warriors. Well, the Romans beat him. And Nebuchadnezzar was a great warrior. But the Medes and the Persians beat him. Then Alexander beat the Medes and the Persians. Then Rome came and took over everybody. God waited till the greatest nation rose to power. And then he sent his son. And through the weakest moment of his son, the weakest moment of Jesus, he defeated the greatest army that ever existed. Now that word stripped, if you go to the book of Colossians, chapter 2, you see what's actually happening. See, things are not the way they look. The Bible says in Matthew that Jesus was being stripped. See, he was stripped naked when he hung on the cross. People put in modesty a little, you know, thing around his waist. When he was really crucified, there was nothing around his waist. He was naked. He was exposed. He was humiliated. He was stripped of everything. But what was really happening? In Colossians chapter 2, verse 15, it says that he disarmed. Now you need to know that word disarmed is the exact same word as stripped in Matthew 27. That when they were stripping Jesus, what he was actually doing was he was stripping them. He was stripping the host of heaven. Satan and all of the demons and all the powerful dark forces, they were being stripped of their power. He was exposing them. When Jesus was hanging naked on the cross, Jesus was actually humiliating them. Because he was defeating them by taking the sin that they use to hold us down and accuse us with. Jesus was paying that debt. So when he was being stripped, he was stripping them. He's a master warrior. He comes in disguise, as it were. You know, and they think they got him. We got him pinned to a cross, but Jesus is so powerful, he defeats the greatest foes while he's hanging on a cross dying. It's so amazing. Your Savior is so amazing that he would come. You know, this is like better than Star Wars, man. I mean, it's just beyond anything you see in the theaters. It's like guerrilla warfare par excellence. I mean, he just comes and they think, oh, he's just a little lamb. Look at the little baby. Oh, how cute. We're going to kill him. And in the process of killing him, you kill yourself as an enemy of his. You destroy yourself. All of his enemies destroyed themselves when they put him on the cross. It's so amazing. It says he disarmed the rulers and authorities and he put them to open shame. And he did it by triumphing over them in the cross, in himself. And so what's going on here, when a Roman government came and conquered a land, what they would do with the king and what they would do with with all of the subjects is they would take them and strip them of all their clothes and parade them around in the streets naked, saying that we're Rome, we brought them down. That's what they did to Jesus. They told him, you take your cross and you carry it to the hill and we're going to crucify you. And while Jesus is carrying his cross to the hill, he's defeating his foes in disguise. This is amazing. And they seal the grave with a Roman seal. What does that mean to Jesus? An angel comes and just kicks the stone aside and sits on top of it, and the grave men start shaking. They don't know what to do. They never seen an angel come from heaven and roll back a stone and break a Roman seal. How dare you? That's death if you break a Roman seal. But you're not going to try to kill an angel. And so the grave men shook and became like dead men, the Bible says, and then out walks the Lord of glory with all authority and all power in his hand. And so while he was being crucified, while he was hanging on a tree dying, he was stripping all of his enemies of all of their power. He was exposing them to open shame, and he was triumphing them. He was taking the cross and saying, I'm dragging you through your own streets, and I'm exposing you and triumphing over you, and I'm doing it without mumbling a word. I'm just praying to my Father in the process, even for forgiveness for his enemies. And so Jesus is amazing. He rules in the midst of his enemies. And so when you see how Jesus brought about salvation, he didn't come on a war horse. He came into Jerusalem on a donkey on a mission to bring peace between God and man. He didn't come swinging a sword, cutting down the Roman guard. He could have, Pilate said, you know, what is truth? And who are you? Are you a king? Jesus could have said one word and Pilate would have turned to dust. He's God Almighty. But how he humbled himself, how he took on the form of a servant, how he humbled himself obediently to the point of dying on a cross for you and I and saying, don't strike them, God. Strike me. I'll take the blow for them to know you and to be saved. For Jesus to go through something like that is amazing. That he would so humble himself and take your sin and your transgression and your iniquities and your perversions and all of your wickedness upon himself, and he became sin, and he said, God, you curse me, don't curse them. Strike me dead, don't strike them. That's amazing love. It's amazing grace. You deserve hell. But Jesus said, I'll take hell. Give them heaven. That's amazing. Doesn't that excite you? That should put fire in you. It should fill you with hope and with joy and with celebration that God Almighty got up on a cross, defeated all your foes. At his weakest point, he defeated your greatest foe to bring you home, to bring you home to himself, and to bring you into his presence where there is fullness of joy and there's pleasures forevermore. That Jesus would do that for you is amazing. And so then, not only that, but it says, your people will offer themselves freely on the day of your power in holy garments. What's he talking about? You're his people. And it says, when you see what Christ has done through the cross for your redemption, that makes you willing to say, here am I, send me. Remember Isaiah in Isaiah 6? Isaiah was a wicked man. He was called to be a prophet. And then when he saw the vision of God Almighty, he says, I am a man of unclean lips. I dwell among a people of unclean lips. My eyes have seen the Holy One of the Lord. And he says, I'm undone. I'm ruined. I'm broken. How can I stand in the presence of God? Then an angel takes a hot coal from the altar, which it points to the sacrificial system. It's pointing to Jesus Christ. And it's through Jesus Christ that the angel comes in and he puts this on Isaiah's lips. And he says, your sin, your iniquity is atoned for. Your sin is removed. And when Isaiah realizes his sin is gone, that he's actually forgiven, that he's actually been washed, he's actually been clean. And God says, well, who's going to go for us? He says, here am I. I'll go. Tell me wherever you want me to go. I'll go. Tell me whatever you want me to say, I'll say. Isaiah is overwhelmed. He's willing because of what Christ has done. You remember the demonic and how he was held captive by a demon. He had control over himself. He used to run around in the tombs. He didn't have any clothes on. They tried to chain him down, and he broke the chains apart. He was a man out of control until he met Jesus. And Jesus stepped on the shores of Gerasenes, and the demon came running over to him and bowed down. And Jesus told the demon to get out of that man. And when that man was set free from the demonic, he said, Jesus, I'll go with you. Let me go with you. And Jesus, he became willing. And Jesus said, you go back and tell the people of this land what God has done for you. Remember the Samaritan woman? She was full of so much shame. She came to get water at a time when you just don't go to get water because it's just too hot. It's just too hot. The sun is beating down on you. You always go at night when it's cooler. The sun has gone down. But she went in the heat of the day because she had so much shame. She didn't want to hang around people. Everybody knew she had been in one marriage and in another marriage and out of this marriage and in another marriage. She had 5 husbands, and she was living with somebody now. And so she had nothing but shame. And so she came to the well to get water when she knew nobody was there. But then Jesus showed up. It said, Jesus told his disciples, I got to go this way today. And he started talking with this woman, and he started having conversation with her, talking about living water, and she's thinking it's a joke. And she says, well, you don't have nothing to draw with, and you're talking about living water. And he starts telling her slowly who he is. And then she starts to realize when he says to her, give me some of the living water. He says, go call your husband. She says, I don't have a husband. See, she's got shame. And he says, you said it right, you don't have. You've had 5 husbands, and the one you're living with now is not your husband. And she said, I perceive you're a prophet. And then she starts talking more, and Jesus says to her, I who speak to you am he. I'm the Messiah. And what does she do? This woman who has so much social shame, she goes running into the middle of the city and says, come meet a man who told me everything I ever did. Couldn't he be the Messiah? And so how many people came to Jesus? It doesn't say, but there's so many people, a crowd of people came and got saved through this woman because she was made willing because this Messiah, even though he showed her sin, he said, I'm your Savior. And he forgave her sin. He gave her living water, and the living water, the Spirit, it points to the Holy Spirit. She became willing to be a witness to the one who could tell her everything she ever done, but now who was going to take it away and give her the victory. She would finally win. She'd finally have a face that she could bring before people without shame, because the shame's been removed. Hasn't it happened that way with you? You know, it's the same with all of us, that all of us are sinners. None of us deserve God. None of us deserve to be in his presence. But it says that your people are made willing in a day of your power. In a day when Jesus comes into his power, at his resurrection, all authority, all power is given to me, Jesus says. How is it that he got all power? It's because he humbled himself to the lowest place of all, so that he might bear your sin and bear your iniquity and bear all of your perversions and take them away from you as far as the east is from the west, and he might cleanse you and bathe you in his blood and clothe you in his righteousness so that you can go up the holy hill and stand in God's holy place and see the face of God without being burned up in his presence. And it's because of that, it's because of his love and because of his grace that he warms your heart and makes you willing to run the race, makes you willing to share the gospel wherever you go, whoever you're with. God makes you willing by his grace. God makes you willing by his love. God makes you willing by his mercy. The Bible says, I beseech you, therefore, brothers, by the mercies of God, to present your bodies as a sacrifice alive to God, holy to God, acceptable to God. It is your reasonable worship. It's the way to worship God. Don't be conformed, but be transformed by the renewing of your mind. God makes you willing when you come to him. Confess your sin. Get cleansed by him. Get clothed by him. Get set free by him. He makes you willing. What Christ has done to redeem, nothing ever will top that. It's top shelf, no matter what you get in life, no matter how much money you have, no matter how much education you have, no matter how many homes you have. If you don't have Jesus, you're missing the point. All this stuff in this world is passing away. There's only one thing that's going to end the day. It's Jesus. his love for you, his blood for you, his righteousness for you? Are you going home one day? Are you excited about seeing Jesus one day, standing in his presence? The Bible says your people are willing in the day of your power in holy garments. What's the holy garment? The holy garment is the character of Christ. That's what makes us willing. And from the womb of the morning, the dew of your youth will be yours. And it's probably pointing to a passage back in 2 Samuel 17:12, where the troops, the army of the Lord, are seen as like the dew in the morning. In 2 Samuel 17, I believe it's verse 12. So we shall come upon him in some place where he is found, and we shall light upon him as the dew falls on the ground, and of him and all the men with him, not one will be left. And so it's talking about how at this particular time, David is thinking about warring against a particular nation, and the troops will come like the dew. And so what God is saying is that when God arranges his troops, they're going to be just like the dew that you see in the morning. There's going to be so many who are willing to volunteer and say, here I am, send me. Here I am, I'll go, Lord, wherever you want me to go. What you have done for me, King Jesus, can't be topped by anything. Nobody can give me what Christ has gave me. Nobody can give you what Christ has given you or wants to give you. No matter what you gain in life, nothing will ever match the blood of Christ, the righteousness of Christ, the love of Christ for you. And it's that love of Christ that Paul says that compels him to no longer live for himself, but for the one who died and was raised again on his behalf. It's the love of Christ. We love because he first loved us. That's why we do all things. It's because of love. It's out of gratitude. It's a big, huge thank you to God. A response to his grace. And then in verse 4 and following, we'll conclude. But in verse 4, in verse 1, God says, it's an utterance, an oracle. But in verse 4, it's stronger. It's a sworn word. It's an oath that God makes. The Lord swears to Jesus Christ. Now, you're probably taught by your parents, don't swear, you know, but this is God doing it, so it's a little different from when you and I try to do it. But God is swearing. It says he's not going to change his mind on this one. Because remember back in 1 Samuel 2:30, the house of Eli, they were the priest, and God had made a covenant with them. But they weren't living like priests. They were living wickedly. They were sleeping around and lying to the people, and they were doing all kinds of wicked things. And God says to them in 1 Samuel 2:30, he says, therefore the Lord, the God of Israel, declares, I promise that your house and the house of your father should go in and out before me forever. But now the Lord declares, far be it from me, for those who honor me I will honor, and those who despise me shall be lightly esteemed. And so God is not changing, but the people have changed. They became against God. And so God says, the promise is only for those who are faithful to me. So God's not changing his mind. The people changed their behavior and their character. And so God says, that promise was for faithful people. You're not faithful people, so the promise is not for you anymore. But what he's saying to Jesus is that I'm making an oath to you. I'm swearing to you. I'm not going to change my mind on this one, because Jesus has already accomplished the work. The Bible says in Hebrews that Jesus sat down, something priests just did not do. Priests were always standing up, serving, doing stuff, because their job was never done. It was never over. They were like moms. You know, a mother's work is never done, right? Amen. But the priests were like mothers. You know, they were always standing. They were always serving. They were always doing something. But Jesus Christ, it says he sat down. It means that what he did was it finalized everything. There was nothing left to do. When he offered up himself, he said, it is finished. He didn't say, I am finished. He says, it is finished. It's all paid in full. Everything that needed to be done for salvation has been accomplished. The work is done. So Jesus took his seat. He sat down. And so the Bible says, God says, that you are a priest forever in the order of Melchizedek. And Melchizedek, as you know, was a priest king. He was a king as well as a priest. Abraham met him in Genesis 14. And the point here about Jesus is that his priesthood will never, ever end. He's able to save you, like someone said, from the guttermost to the uttermost, because he always lives to intercede for you. His priesthood is eternal. It goes on forever and ever. So he can always intercede for you. So if in this battle that God has called you to, if in this race that God has called you to run, you sometimes fall down. We all sometimes fall down. But here's the priest who can bring you to court and who can show his hands and show his feet and say, it's all paid for. Look at these nail prints. Their sin is all paid for. It's all paid for. I'm the propitiation, is what Jesus says. I absorbed the wrath of God against their sin over 2,000 years ago. It's all paid for. Forgive this person. Jesus pleads for your forgiveness. He always gets what he pleads for. And so in Christ, he's your advocate. He speaks in your behalf to the Father for your cleansing and for your being made more like him. And not only that, but it says in Romans 8, that if God is for you, who can be against you? He who did not spare his own son, but gave him up for us all, how will he not also with him graciously give us all things? Who shall bring any charge against God's elect? It is God who justifies. Who is the one who condemns? Christ Jesus is the one who died, yes, was indeed raised again, who also intercedes for you. What is going to separate you from the love of God? Nothing can separate you from the love of Christ. And the Bible goes on through a whole list. Shall tribulation or distress or persecution or famine or nakedness or danger or sword, as it is written, for your sake, for Jesus' sake, we are being killed all day long. We are regarded as sheep to be slaughtered. See, serving Jesus is worth dying for. He's worth it. And see, but even it says here, for your sake, we are being killed all day long. We are regarded as sheep to be slaughtered. Things are not the way they appear. He goes on to say, no, in all these things, we are more than conquerors. Through him who loved us, for I am persuaded that neither death nor life, nor angels, nor principalities, nor powers, nor things to come, nor rulers, height, depth, nothing in all creation will ever separate you from the love of God, which is in Christ Jesus. And so this high priest is able, he's taken his seat, he intercedes for you, he's going to pray you right to heaven. And in your daily life, when you go through all kinds of struggles and difficulties, this priest is interceding for you, and he's praying for you. And why is this so important? And we close with this particular couple of thoughts. This is so integral that when you willingly offer yourself to Jesus to serve him, wherever you might be, you fall down on that job. You have a priest who will speak in your defense and enable you to get back to that race and get back to that service. Because why is it so important and why is it so urgent that you give yourself to the service of God? You know, you can give yourself to your schoolwork, and you should. You can give yourself to your job, and you should. You can give yourself to giving, getting, you know, marriage and family and all these things. All these things are good. But above all these things, what is supposed to direct all of these things is the kingdom of God. And why is it so important? Because Jesus came the first time. He came to bring heaven. Jesus is coming again, and he's coming to bring hell. For real. And you see that in these verses that follow, the last verses, 5-7. It says, the Lord is at your right hand. He will shatter kings on the day of his wrath. See, this is why it's so important, because the day of salvation has come. The day of wrath is on its way. And it says he will execute judgments among the nations, filling them with corpses. You have pictures in the prophets of Jesus, and he comes back from battle, and his garments are stained with blood. And they say, well, why are they stained with blood? It's because he has been stomping people to death. See, Jesus comes back. He's already brought salvation. He's brought the cross. He's given the way. When he comes back again, he's not taking prisoners. He's coming to fill the place with corpses, the Bible says. He's going to come and wreck the place. He will shatter chiefs over the wide earth. And then it says he will drink from the brook on the way. He will not be, what you know, when kings fought, they used to get refreshment. They would fight, then they would get refreshed, and they would keep at the battle. It says here to this king, he will drink from the brook. therefore he will lift up his head in victory. He will defeat every one of his enemies. Jesus Christ is coming to conquer every single enemy there is over this whole terrain. No one will escape. And so this is why it's so crucial for God's people who know Jesus to share Jesus and live for Jesus like there is no tomorrow. Because there may be no tomorrow for someone, and there may be no more opportunity for you to serve him because you don't know when you're leaving this place. And so what application can we leave? The application was read to you already in Psalm chapter 2. You see it there, and we will conclude with this. In verse 6 of Psalm 2, it says, "As for me, I have set my king." This is again the Lord speaking to Jesus on Zion, my holy hill. And then in verse 7, this is Jesus speaking. "I will tell of the decree. The Lord said to me, 'You are my son. Today I have begotten you.' Ask of me the nations." God is saying to Jesus, "Ask, pray for the nations. I'll give them to you. Pray that you would have total possession of the earth. I'll give it to you." And so Jesus prayed that prayer. And look at verse 9. "He shall break them with a rod of iron and dash them to pieces like a potter's vessel." Jesus has come and has laid on the cross naked. He's exposed himself. He was beat up, battered, bruised, and bloody. And he said, "Here I am. Come to me. I will save you. I will wash you. I will have communion with you forever." And the implication is, if you don't do that, when I come back, I'm not coming back to hang on the cross a second time. I'm coming back with a scepter, and I'm coming back to stomp people to death. And see, so it's the two motivations of serving the Lord. It's the motivation of love. It's the power of God's love. He's been gracious. He's been loving. He's been merciful. I'm willing to go. But it's also the fear. It's the terror of the Lord that also, that's the same thing that Paul says in the same passage, that he says, "The love of Christ compels me." Right before that, he says, "We knowing the terror of the Lord, we persuade men." Because we know that Jesus is not taking prisoners when he comes back again. He's not going to be sweet and cuddly and cozy like a little baby. He's coming back as a king, as a warrior, and he's coming to kill people and to put them to death and send them in hell. And it's his love that makes you willing to say, "I don't want to see my neighbor in hell." Because when Jesus comes back, he's keeping his promises. And so, in chapter 2, verse 10, it says, "So now, therefore, kings, be wise." You know, when you think about all that Christ has done, be wise about this. Be warned. See, you've received the warning. And so serve the Lord with fear. Rejoice with trembling. Kiss the Son. Be devoted to him. Worship him. Kiss him. Give him your full homage, lest he be angry. You don't want to make, remember the Incredible Hulk? "Mr. McGee, you don't want to make me angry. You wouldn't like me when I'm angry. It's Hollywood. This is the real one. Jesus, it says, lest he be angry and you perish in the way. For his wrath is stirred up," it says, "quickly kindled. Blessed are all who take refuge in him." Would you take refuge in him? If you don't know him, take refuge in him and you are safe. You don't take refuge in him, you are in trouble. People sometimes come to me and say, "Are you in trouble?" I say, "I'm not in trouble. I'm in Christ." I'm never in trouble when you're in Christ. But if you're not in Christ, you are in trouble. Take refuge in him, because there is no refuge from him. When he comes back, he's not taking any prisoners. This is the message of the resurrection. He's been raised. So love him. If you don't love him, you're in trouble. That's the message. God bless. Let's pray. Our Father, in Christ's name, we do come. We give thanks to you for Jesus. We thank you that simply coming, simply confessing, simply saying, "I'm a sinner, I need your salvation," does the job. We're safe in him. Father, I pray that you stir in our hearts such an awakening, such a desire, such a willingness, that we don't need coercion, that we are eager to proclaim Christ, eager to live for Christ, eager to be the light and the salt you called us to be, so that others who don't know you might not taste your wrath or your anger. God, we thank you that there's no condemnation in Christ for any who believe, for all who believe. Father, help us to get to work wherever we are, serving you and sharing you, so that the world might know you. In Christ's name, amen.